And for some reason, they lost touch with their history. They lost touch with their heritage. They lost touch with their culture. They lost touch with their covenant, and they lost touch with God.
Amen.
Yes.
The past was forgotten and ignored. And eventually, it was redefined. What happens when the favored nation and people fail to honor the God who bestowed that favor on them? In the book of Deuteronomy, the 28th chapter, it says, "And you shall become an astonishment, a proverb, and a byword among all nations where the Lord will drive you." And people say, "Pastor, what does that mean?" That means they would be mocked. They would be ridiculed by other nations. They would be taunted. They would be jived. No respect would be found whatsoever. And ironically, the thing Israel wanted the most, to be like everyone else, to be liked by everyone else, would lead them to be despised as a nation. They assumed they could do what was right in their own eyes and all would be well. Everything would evolve into something better. But the result was death, rejection, destruction, ruin, and captivity. Advocates and proponents of change compel us to look forward, not look backwards. They talk about the hope and the light of the future, not the dismal recesses of the past. And that sounds noble, doesn't it? Sounds inspirational. Sounds good. It's better than what we had in the past. Change is supposed to evolve us into something superior, something improved, more improved than what we were. From a biblical perspective, the popular message of national change is definitely missing something. It ignores the established record of the past and it rewrites it. The facts and reality get in the way, redefine them. If established laws, brother, block the path of change, ignore them. Erase them. Replace them with laws that accommodate change.
Right.
For those nations in covenant and God, change is a problem. In Malachi it says, "For I, the Lord, do not change. Therefore you, O sons of Jacob, are not consumed." And Hebrews says, "Christ is the same today, yesterday, and forever."
Amen.
We serve a God that doesn't change. In Isaiah it says, "Remember these things, O Jacob and Israel, for you are my servant. I have formed you. You are my servant, O Israel. You will not be forgotten by me. I have wiped out your transgressions like a thick cloud and your sins like a heavy mist. Return to me, for I redeemed you." In Jeremiah it says, "Go and proclaim these words toward the north and say, return, faithless Israel, declares the Lord. I will not look upon you in anger, for I am gracious, declares the Lord. I will not be angry forever." God doesn't call his people to change. He always calls his people to return, to go back, rediscover those ancient paths that led to God and to his work.
Yes.
And when his people come to realize the errors of the way, that they needed God, they didn't say, "Let's change." They said, "Come, let us return to the Lord, and he will heal us." I agree with the president. Change has come to America.
Yes.
God help us.
Yes.
They talk about changing the fundamentals. They talk about fundamentally transforming America. The fundamentals are the foundational principles on which this nation was built and sustained. Change suggests the things of the past need to be replaced with something new. Change and fundamentally transform America suggests that the America of the past needs to be replaced with something unintended by the founders of this nation and the framers of our Constitution. Regardless of what the politicians and the political pundits would have us believe, America today as I preach at the revival, is in a cold blue Christ.
Yes.
Major and local.
Yes.
Moral, international, financial, agricultural, spiritual, all of it. It's become so bad that corrupt and inept leadership, natural disasters, terror alerts, they no longer shock us. They don't move us anymore. It's become so common. We are now focusing after going after other gods. And in the process, we make the same fatal error that Israel made so long ago. When all religions are considered equal, all relationships, biblical or not, are considered equal. And I'm going to tell you, when certain species of fish are protected by the law, but unborn babies are not, it's a telltale sign that change has come to America, and we've abandoned the covenant between us and God.
Yes.
Amen.
And I think to myself, America's transformation can't be intentional, for no one would intentionally set out to embrace death. Because Proverbs says there is a way which seems right to men, but it ends in the way of death. See what it is? The devil is operating in his bang zone, man. In his zone where he's deceived us into thinking that evil is good. He plays on our weaknesses. Jeremiah says, "For my people are foolish. They know me not. They are stupid children and have no understanding. They are shrewd to do evil, but to do good they do not know. We run to the next bright, shiny thing, thinking they always bring good, bring life. And then we find out that it's only the devil masquerading as the angel of light, bringing death and destruction. We've been deceived by the great deceiver. America wants change that permits us to do whatever we want. Whatever we please. Even if it means Brother Mike redefining marriage. Refusing to honor life in the womb.
Yes.
Israel had changed like that too. They were once his chosen vineyard. And they turned into people that rewarded evil and hated good. Isaiah said, "Woe to those who call good evil good and good evil. Who put darkness for light and light for darkness. Who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight. Who justify the wicked for a bribe and take away justice from the righteous man. Therefore, as the fire devours the stubble and the flame consumes the chaff, so their root will have been rotten, as their blossom will ascend like dust. Because they have rejected the laws of the Lord God of hosts and despised the Holy One of Israel." There isn't a quick, easy 12-step plan to replace God in America. It's been subtle. It's been sneaky. The serpent, Genesis says the serpent was the most subtle beast of the field. They've done it a little at a time. We've been forced to tolerate. We've been forced to tolerate. Anything less is seen as insensitive, judgmental, bullying. We're hate mongers. We got to go along to get along, to coexist. I'm going to tell you, the tares weren't sown into the wheat to coexist in harmony and tolerance. The goal of the tares is to overtake the wheat so it can fulfill its purpose to kill, steal, and destroy. And when we talk about tares and we talk about wheat, we're talking about, anybody know what a tare is? It's a weed. It's a weed that grows in the field and it eventually takes over the field. It started in 1963 by taking out prayer, Bible out of prayer. And now it's come to the point where pastors are being threatened with legal suits and jail because of what they preach in the pulpit. With charges. I'm telling you, that don't scare me a bit. Because I've been there. What's another charge, man? I've got a list of them. That don't scare me.
Amen.
But that's what they're talking about.
Yes.
want you to, don't think for a minute, don't think for a minute that all the concessions made by churches and Christians and Christ-centered government will satisfy the atheist, the homosexual agenda, or the pro-abortion people. These groups will never be satisfied.
Right.
They'll never be satisfied until God's word is silent. Till the moral boundaries set in place by our founding fathers inspired by God's word are entirely removed. Those who call for change, by the way, that was the Democrat Party in the riot in 2012, are not being honest about what kind of change they're in favor of making.
Right.
God-fearing, Bible-believing, gun-carrying, conservative, patriotic Americans have made to feel unfair and out of touch when we speak fondly and look up to the honors of our founding fathers. Today, they call our founding fathers a bunch of old, rich, dead men who were bigots and sexist. I'm going to tell you what they've done. They've invaded our schools, and they've invaded our universities.
Yes.
And they've taught our children this stuff. My daughter goes to USI, and she loves to come in and tell me what her professors say because she knows it just drives me crazy. And she loves to come in and tell me this stuff. But you would not believe what they're seducing our children.
Yes.
They're seducing them to forget about patriotism. They say it's okay to burn the flag, that that's just showing your individuality, and that's showing. They're seducing our children in our colleges, in our high school, in our college, our university, where they're supposed to be training our children, but they are training our children. But they want them to forget. I bet our kids in our university cannot tell you anything about our history from 1960 back. I bet they know nothing. I know my daughter. She doesn't know anything about World War II. I mean, just what I've told her. She's never been taught that in school. They've never been taught what true patriotism is. They've never been taught that our country was once great. They've never been taught. We've been made to feel like we've got to apologize to the world for being American. Our president goes everywhere and apologizes I see where he was in Japan not too long ago. And he was visiting the sites of where the atomic bombs were dropped. Same old story. Well, I'll tell you what, I'm sorry. I'm sorry because I'm still proud, amen?
Yeah.
The flag still stands for freedom, amen?
Yeah.
And freedom is still worth fighting for. And we're still one nation under God.
Yeah.
And my America is still a Christian nation.
Yeah.
And America is still, marriage is still between one man and one woman for
a
lifetime. And life does start at contraception. And I'll pray in the name of Jesus because he saved me.
Yeah.
And if that doesn't fit your change, you can keep your change. Amen.
Amen.
It's obvious America has abandoned God. But what's more important is, has God abandoned America? Jesus said in Matthew, "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill that cannot be hidden." If America is that city set on a hill in the eyes of the world, what do they see? What are they supposed to see? From God's perspective, they should see a nation that's serving Him. And the world should see a nation that experiences the blessing, the favor bestowed upon them by Him. Amen?
Yes.
This is what Moses alluded to in the wilderness when he told Israel. He said, "Surely I have taught you statutes and judgments just as the Lord my God commanded, that you should act according to them in the land which you go to possess. Therefore, be careful to observe them, for this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of people who will hear all these statutes and say, 'Surely This is a great nation and is wise and understandable. For what great nation is there that has God so near to it as the Lord our God is to us? For whatever reason we may call upon him, and what great nation is there that has such statutes and righteous judgments as are in all the laws which I set before you on this day? Only take heed to yourself and diligently keep yourself, lest you forget the things your eyes have seen, and lest you depart from your heart all the days of your life, and teach them to your children and to your grandchildren.
Yes.
Moses is simply saying to remember what you learned in the past, and these things are very important to sustain you in your future.
Yes.
Be true to them. Reap the benefits of liberty, life, and the pursuit of happiness. And other nations will see you blessed by God and know your God.
Yes.
That was just like in the Old Testament with Nebuchadnezzar and Daniel and the three Hebrew children. When he seen the blessings of God, he said, "Your God is the only God."
That's right.
That's what would happen to us.
Uh-huh.
What happens to a nation that forgets their past, rejects God, forsakes his commands? Once again, "And you shall become an astonishment, a proverb, and a byword among all nations, where the Lord will drive you." We're ridiculed by other nations. Other nations show us no respect, and we're despised by everyone. Amen? Here's the thing. No other nation forced Israel to forget their past, to reject God and his command. See, other nations didn't have that authority. In the garden, the serpent didn't make Adam and Eve eat the forbidden fruit. He deceived them into thinking it was what's best for them. Genesis said, saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eye, and the tree was desirable to make one wise. She took it, fruit, and ate. God's covenant people, us, can't be cursed by others because they don't have the authority. It's not China, it's not Iran, and it's not Russia's fault. We are where we are.
Right.
America has chosen to be where we are.
Sure. Amen.
Abraham Lincoln warned, "At what point then is the approach of danger to be expected? I answer, if it ever reaches us, it must spring up among us. It cannot come from abroad. If destruction be our lot, we must ourselves be its author and finisher. As a nation of free men, we must live together through all time or die by suicide." We've chosen death. We've chosen death over life, darkness over life, change over eternity. It's not forced on us. This change has occurred because we've encouraged God to leave our schools, to leave our courthouse, to leave our public places. We've welcomed all religion and said they're all the same. They are not.
Amen.
They are not.
Amen.
That's what Israel thought. And the next thing you know, they're worshiping all the other gods. And God turned his back on them. All religions are not the same. There's only one religion, and that's a Christian religion.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
We can never be one nation under God until we are under God.
Yes.
Under the one God. Amen.
Yes.
You know, if you're married, Brother Bud, you're married. If you start to flirt with other women, your relationship's going downhill fast, isn't it?
Out of touch.
Marriage is a covenant.
Yes.
Marriage is a covenant.
Yes.
That requires you to be exclusively in covenant with the other person.
Yes.
We are in a covenant with God, and he will not allow us to flirt with other gods.
Amen.
The tares don't coexist with the wheat intolerance. The tares don't say, oh, we're going to all live together. The tares have an agenda. I'm telling you, the tares have an agenda, and their agenda doesn't end until they have taken over the field. I'm telling you, there are people in this country with an agenda, and they're not going to end until they've taken over this country, until they've run God completely out of it. Change has come to America.
Yes.
God help us.
Yes.
A Fort Worth high schooler was sent home for a one-day suspension for telling another classmate he believed homosexuality was wrong. He was called a bigot, and they said the reason why they suspended him was because of a hate speech. A few years ago, a woman in Orange County was fined $300 for having a Bible study in her own home. We've kicked him out of schools, we've kicked him out of the public places, now we're kicking him out of private homes. At Washington's National Cathedral, an interfaith prayer vigil was held on the anniversary of 9/11. The speakers consisted of the Bishop of Washington, a rabbi, an incarnate lama, a Buddhist nun, a Hindu priest, the president of the Islamic Society of North America, a Muslim, and an imam. Not one evangelical Christian was invited. A spokesman for the cathedral admitted that the evangelicals were purposely omitted from the program, stating that diversity was first and foremost in planning the service. Well, I'm going to tell you what diversity is. You want to know what diversity is? That means tolerating anything that goes on. Diversity means mixing the holy with the profane.
Yes.
And change has come to America.
Yes. Amen. That's right.
Amen. America has strayed from our moral principles that helped guide the founders of this nation and made this nation what it once was. And I'm going to tell you right now, if you look around, this nation is collapsing into chaos, madness, division, and unrest. Yes. Just look around. Just look around and see what you see. We are following the same ancient path of Israel into slavery. Slavery of the state. Slavery of the government. In Numbers, in Exodus, after they received their freedom and their liberty, they wanted to go back to Egypt. See, they were willing to surrender their liberty to a totalitarian government who would feed them and give them house care and health care and housing rather than live free under God who would give them what they needed.
Amen.
I'm going to quote George Washington here from an inaugural speech he made. America will endure until the people of America shall have lost all virtue, until they have become totally insensible to the difference between freedom and slavery, until they shall have been reduced to such poverty of spirit as to be willing to sell that preeminent blessing, the birthright of a free man, for a mess of pottage. In short, until they have been found incapable of governing themselves and are right for a master. William Penn said, those who will not be governed by God will be ruled by tyrants.
Yes.
I'm going to tell you, the time Washington and Penn have warned us about has come.
Yes.
To America.
Yes.
Our disregard for God's word and principles have brought us, and I truly believe we're on the verge of collapse. Change has come to America. I'm telling you right now, we're flirting with the fact. And the only way that we can avoid this disaster as a nation is through revival. And through repentance. As a nation, as individuals, we can repent, but as a nation, if we don't repent, we're going to have to go through some stuff. Me and Brother Bogle were talking the other day. He said, do you think, you know, we'll have to go through this collapse? I said, yeah. Yeah, because this is not the tribulation we're talking about. Because we're not going to be here for the tribulation. But we're going to see some bad times. I truly believe that we're the generation that is going to see America collapse if we don't have a national revival and national repentance.
Yeah.
But I also believe we're going to be the generation that that sees the return of the Lord. Amen?
Amen. Yeah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
So today, I want to ask you to think about that. Are you willing to embrace this? Or are you willing to stand up for God?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
If you would stand, please.